Good morning. Grace to you and peace in the name of Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship here at St. Andrew's Presbyterian. If you're tuning in, then a good chance that it is because we have had to cancel our worship this morning because of inclement weather. But the online presence we have allows us to continue to worship in a different way. So we are glad that you've been able to tune in this morning. Just a word of information. On mornings such as this, with some kind of bad weather or change in our environment that allows us to worship, we have a system in our congregation to make that happen, to make a decision, and then we try to communicate that to the larger congregation. The best way to find out information if we are closed for on-site worship is to check our webpage and our social media accounts, or to go online to WRAL and their weather ticker that will announce our closing or change of our hours. And another way simply is as you look outside in your own home, and if the roads look bad or if you do not have power, assume we don't either and the roads are bad around here and stay home safely. Let us now prepare ourselves for worship.
We sang this song back in the fall, and I hope that you remember it. And I'm putting these songs in keys that you can sing at home. So please sing along with me. And if you're not singing, just please hum with me. This is Lord, I Need You.
Lord, I need you. Guides my heart, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, Lord, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need.
The scripture reading this morning is from the Psalm 29. Listen for the word of God. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord glory of God's name and worship the Lord in holy splendor. For the voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders, the Lord over mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon skip like a calf and Syrian like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord flashes forth flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord causes the oaks to whirl and strips the forest bare, and his temple all say glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood, enthroned as king forever. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. Thanks be to God for this reading from his word. We have a little dog at our house, a little beagle, about 6 years old, and Lucy does not like loud noises. She doesn't like bad weather. She doesn't like inclement weather. She doesn't like a hurricane or a rain or a snowstorm or ice, and she doesn't like a thunderstorm. Hides in the house. And I'm reminded sometimes of that scene in Sound of Music when a storm descends upon the family von Trapp and the new Countess Maria, and suddenly little Gretel shows up on the Countess's bed, and then all the children come in one by one. And of course, Maria has to answer this with a song, so she sings of nice things, right? Of like raindrops on roses and whiskers on kittens and bright copper kettles and warm woolen mittens. Well, there's a storm in our psalm today, but the psalmist does not sing of such things. The psalmist then considers God, the Almighty. Now, Psalm 29 might be one of the oldest psalms in the scriptures. Some scholars believe Israel adapted it from the religions in their area and used it for its own purpose. The psalmist hears the storm and makes different profound associations. The storm reminds the psalmist of the power of God. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord thunders, flashes forth fire, shakes the wilderness. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars, makes the land of Lebanon scatter away like frightened puppies. We don't generally make those associations today, do we? It's out of fashion to talk about the voice of God, to speak of the power of God, even. You know, people just don't hear the voice of God that way. If they do, we're suspicious of them. Quite honestly, when it comes to the Almighty these days, it isn't always power that we associate with God. We'll see power in a diesel engine or a battalion of soldiers or a squadron of fighter jets and the grandeur of technology and the rhetoric or grandiosity of our leaders. That seems to be power these days. And God, for us, often seems to be none of that. For some, God's power is almost like an absentee father, someone we call on in a crisis in hope, but not always expect he delivers. So the psalm can feel archaic to you, perhaps, drawing up with some religion of the past. So to appreciate it, though, you almost have to step into the world that the psalmist is in. Like, have you ever been in a thunderstorm? I'll start with that question. And not just a thunderstorm outside, and you're safe inside your house, considering the bright copper kettles and warm woolen mittens and apple strudels or whatever, but if you're actually outside during a storm, that can be a different experience. A friend of mine was telling me such an experience a few years ago. He was out duck hunting down east late in the fall, and he took his little boat out across this little area and then went to his little duck blind. It was cold, it was icy, it was a tough night, and it was a pretty, but then suddenly the storm began to arise. He could see it coming across the horizon toward him, and he could see it was going to be difficult, and so he tried to get back in his transportation. It didn't start. These great engines he depended on didn't work, so he took cover in his duck blind as the storm blew in, and he said it was unnerving, frightening, unsettling, as the storm crashed and thundered all about him. And it is there, in the water, in the storm, in the duck blind, if you will, when we realize how small we are. That's one thing you might notice in the song. Humans feel rather small, so small they're not even there. That's what's unusual about this psalm. You know, most psalms, you know, there's somebody singing to God or praying to God or offering a lament or a praise. Not here. There's no humans in the story. This is a drama of heavenly beings happening. They, not us, are being called upon to assign and submit to the singular force of the Almighty. If you read it, it's like a drama acting out in the heavens. And the listeners just kind of watch from afar, like children listening in from another room as their parents negotiate. In this psalm, the Almighty is doing that very thing among heavenly agents. And none of it has to do with us. There's a distance, there's an awesomeness, there's an intimidation in this psalm, like sitting in a field and looking up at a light show in the heavens. So the psalm, therefore, is like a humbling reminder that there is more in this world than us. There is something going on in this world beyond us, beyond our individual stories, beyond our individual problems, beyond our impressions of what power is, beyond the tanks and the technology. There's a power beyond all that, and the psalm draws you into that world. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord thunders. The voice of the Lord flashes and shakes. People often dismiss this kind of psalm these days as archaic, as a product of some ancient religion, as confusing elements of nature with God. But there's a warning in the scripture. And that is, do not dismiss the Almighty. It's interesting to appreciate this. One thing the psalm does, it helps us consider our size. You know, in a given day, our beagle is a great king over her little yard. She rules it, and she is powerful, and she is vocal, and she struts around that yard. But as soon as we let her out of the fence and get her on a leash and go on a walk, suddenly she's not so confident, not so sure of herself and the world around her. That's true of a lot of folks. It's natural. Because our worlds are shaped by our families and our jobs and our interests and our locations. And the problem of a small world is twofold. One, when our worlds are small, then no one is getting in to help us or teach us anything different, including God. And secondly, when our worlds are small, then we become so very big, so very confident in ourselves and who we are and what we're about. So when our worlds are so small, it's a confused view. And it's true of anything, as us as individuals, or us as a congregation, or us as a country, we become myopic to our own needs, our own desires, blind to the world beyond us. And the anecdote of such a small thing is the duck blind, if you will. The wonder of creation and all its drama reminds us of our size. You know, we can build levees to keep out water, but it can, you know, the waters can rise over them. We can build a rocket to the moon, but on a day it rains, then they scrap the mission. In the early 90s, 92, 93, I think it was, the upper plains received more rain than usual, and the Mississippi and Missouri's began to flood, and they just flooded all the way down, and so much so that, you know, they overflowed its banks, and roads big major highways were cut off. The nation was almost cut in half, at least by the roads. A reminder that creation is sometimes beyond our best efforts. The wonder of creation can remind us of our size. And it's good sometimes to be reminded of that, because people can sometimes feel too big, or your problems feel too big, or your ego. God is not the storm. God is not the wind or the rain. God is not Zeus. God is not the storm. God's beyond it. But the storms serve to remind us, to serve notice, that there's an awesomeness to God that cannot be captured, that's often forgotten, that's awkward to name, that's mysterious to solve, that's frightening to behold, and that's humbling to witness. At the end of the psalm, after the thundering and after the mighty waters and the breaking of the cedars and the scattering of the calves and the flashing of the lightning and the shaking of the wilderness and after the voice of the Lord being repeated again and again and again, there comes two little lines directed to humanity. May God give strength to his people, and may God give them peace. It is as if the psalmist makes a point. After one beholds the awesomeness of the Almighty, there's often very little talking from us, just a heavy gulp and a consideration and a prayer that God give us strength and peace. Out on the duck blind, that was my friend's prayer for strength and peace. God is bigger than our problems. God is bigger than our worlds. God is bigger than our egos, bigger than our country, bigger than our jobs and our families and our needs and our desires and than our theologies. God is bigger than our beliefs about God. And I'm not sure if that should frighten us or encourage us, but that is the way it is. And at the very least, it is this. This is God's world, and we just live in it. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O God of the earthquake and the storm, and God of the trumpet blast, and God of the hungry and the sick and the prodigals, God of the loving hand and the loving heart, we stand in awe. We can be frustrated by your ways. We can be mystified by your ways, but we are in need of your ways. We are in need of your power and your presence in this world and in our lives. To bless the hurting and the hungry and the homeless, and to bless the lonely and the frightened, to bless the suffering and the sick, to bless the dying and the mourning and the despairing. And not just that, but to equip us as people not too big to sidle up to those who need that presence and that power. So make us sizes just right to be with those who are, to step to those who are hungry and hurting and homeless and lonely and frightened and in danger. Let us be advocates and witnesses and friends. We pray these prayers in the powerful name of Almighty God, who came to us in the presence of a lowly servant named Jesus and taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
As we've been reminded that God is greater than all of our problems,
I thought I'd sing a medley of songs about God's greatness, and I hope you'll sing along wherever you are. Weighed us down with sickness all around. There's problems everywhere. We fall into despair, but we hold on to faith in the Lord who is so great. Our God will make us strong with power to press on. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hands hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Creator, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen.